Marie Porter, the daughter of George Kappen and Anna Hieger. Porter, 37 at the time of her execution, had contracted a hit on her brother to collect the $3,300 life insurance. Porter's brother, William Kappen, was shot on his wedding day just 2 hours before he was to be married. Had the murder occurred after the ceremony, Porter would no longer have been the beneficiary of the insurance policy. If the groom is going to be murdered on his wedding day, we expect the killer to be a jilted lover driven to madness by a broken heart or a rival suitor of the bride who cannot stand to let another take his place. In these cases, their crime is motivated by jealousy inflamed by passion. We do not expect that the woman who arranged the murder to be the groom's sister who wanted him killed for the insurance money. For doing exactly that, Marie Porter holds the dubious place in history of being the first woman to die in Illinois' electric chair. It is an honor she well deserves. For acting as the actual trigger man in the 1937 murder, Angelo Ralph Giancola preceded Porter to the chair. His story is not new. A weak young man duped into committing murder by a stronger-willed older woman. He is unique in the annals of crime as the only killer whose case of poison ivy proved to be fatal. For his lesser role in the plot, John, Anthony's younger brother, received a sentence of 99 years. The crime committed by a 250-pound widow and her young lover was so heinous that even the state's governor, staunchly anti-death penalty, refused to commute her sentence as he had done for every other woman condemned to be executed. At their sentencing, the judge said the crime shocked the conscience. If there ever was a more deliberate, premeditated, cold-blooded and atrocious murder, I've never heard of it, Judge Dick A. Mudge said in passing sentence. I have earnestly, but in vain, examined the record to find some mitigating circumstance in connection with this crime. The seeds of Porter's plan to kill her younger brother, William Kappen, were planted back in 1935 when Porter's husband was gunned down by her father during an argument. The old man was judged insane and taken to an asylum. Porter collected a decent insurance settlement on her husband's death, but with 4 children to feed and clothe, she was soon facing the threat of poverty. For reasons known only to herself, she chose murder as the answer to her problems. Her criminally insane elderly father was not much help as a potential victim, so she began looking at other relatives. After careful consideration, she settled on William. Her brother had never married and named his poverty-stricken sister as the beneficiary of a $3,000 life insurance policy. In the early days of 1937, Marie became involved with the bricklayer Giancola, taking the young man as her lover. Almost immediately, she told police, she began planting the idea that Kappen needed to be put away. Her main argument, to which Giancola testified at their trial, was not that they would live like royalty on a one-time $3,000 payout, nor was it that she would use the money to support her 4 daughters, the eldest of whom was 15. Instead, in between lovemaking sessions, Porter said Kappen had been relying on her support for years, and now it was time to pay back. I carried my brother through the depression, she later told police. And when he told me he was going to get married, I didn't want him to, because he still owed me a good sum of money. Once Giancola surrendered to her coaxing, the pair started researching various ways to kill Kappen. After her arrest for her brother's murder, Porter discussed the mechanics of the crime with Cole dispatch. We discussed drowning him, but this didn't seem advisable, for Bill was a good swimmer, she said. We also thought about pushing him off a bluff at Riverview Park. That was several months ago. On July 4th, police in Belleville, Illinois, on east side of the Mississippi about 15 miles from St. Louis, were alerted to the body of a man on a deserted stretch of road. Clues at the scene made it obvious that the man had been kidnapped. The man had dressed hastily, for he wore no underclothing. Two blood-soaked handkerchiefs were found in a poison ivy weed. The gun was not found. St. Louis had a very active underworld at the time, and the crime had all of the earmarks of a gang rub-out. Thus the case was treated for about 24 hours by investigators, until a jilted bride came forward with a mysterious tale. Irene Traub was the wife-to-be of Bill Kappen, who, the day before, was left at the altar of St. Anthony's Catholic Church in St. Louis. She said she had not spoken to Bill since July 2nd, the day before the intended wedding. There was nothing in his demeanor that indicated he was getting cold feet. Irene told police that after the initial tears had passed, her sadness turned into anger, and she was determined to find Bill and hold him to account. At least that was her plan until she read in the paper that Illinois police had the body of an unidentified man whose description matched Bill's. Before taking her fears to the police, Irene went to Bill's apartment to see if it held any clues to Bill's actions. The scene in the flat fit the clues at the crime scene the way a key fits its lock. Neatly pressed, the bridegroom's wedding suit was laid out on a bed which had either been freshly made or not slept in the night before. Bill was interrupted in the process of getting ready for a bath. The tub was half filled with water, but the washcloth and soap looked disturbed. One clue was difficult to explain, however. Bill was not a smoker, but several cigarette butts were crushed into the carpet in his bedroom. This indicates someone else was in the apartment, of course, but were they lying in wait, or did they arrive after Bill? If the killers were waiting to kidnap Bill, why was he allowed to start a bath? If he had been in a long conversation with someone he knew, why had he dressed so quickly? Why would he allow someone to grind out their cigarettes on his run? Irene was taken to the morgue where she identified Bill's body. Police quickly established that Kappen was in no way connected with St. Louis organized crime and had no known enemies. There was only one person who would benefit from his death, and that was his sister, Marie Porter. She was brought into the station for an interview that quickly turned into an interrogation. The cops had done their homework in a very short time and confronted Porter with their knowledge of her young lover, and said he was being interviewed in a nearby room. If they had hoped this would loosen her tongue, they were sadly mistaken. Down the hall, Giancola was quite uncomfortable, and not just because of the bad case of poison ivy that was driving him crazy. It was his scratching that really broke the case wide open, because it unquestionably put him at the scene of the crime and was something he could not explain away. One does not simply walk around urban St. Louis and catch a case of poison ivy. Confronted with this, Giancola gave his first confession, which was mostly bogus. I met Mrs. Porter on the night of the murder, and she gave me $10 to hire an automobile. She told me to drive to Kappen's home. I waited outside, and half an hour later she and Bill came out together. She got in the back seat and Bill got in front with me. We stopped at a roadside tavern for some drinks. Bill was getting worried, for he was going to be married the next morning. We told him we would get him back in time. As we drove out toward Belleville, Mrs. Porter called to Bill. As he turned around, I heard a shot, and he slumped over toward me. Parts of the confession are truthful. He explained that he caught the poison ivy after using the handkerchiefs to wipe blood off his hands and clothes, and the murder occurred where he said it did, at least in the geographic sense. The immediate destruction of the relationship between the widow and the bricklayer, forged with such fragile bonds, probably happened like Giancola said. She told me if I said anything it would be too bad for me, he confessed. There was no blood in the car and the amount at the scene indicated Bill was standing beside the car when he was shot point blank. No witnesses could be found who could place Porter with either Bill or Giancola. This looked as if it was going to be one of those cases where guilt could be established everywhere except in a court of law. Murderers must lack two emotional traits to be successful. They must not possess any moral compunction against killing, and they must not fear being caught and punished. Those who kill know this by consciousness, without thinking about it at all, while the rest of us shake our heads in befuddlement. But one thing that people who pay close attention to crime instinctively know, but which killers do not count on, is that murder brings on feelings of guilt and a never-ending feeling of impending doom. In this case, those unexpected emotions proved too much for one young man to bear, and in an attempt to ease his conscience, Giancola's brother, John, whom police had not even considered as a suspect, appeared at the detective bureau and promptly confessed everything. John not only implicated himself in the crime, he said his brother pulled the trigger while he stood by as a willing participant. The motive was $800 promised by Porter. The timing was the forthcoming nuptials. She said she couldn't wait another day because Bill was going to get married, he confessed. He would probably sign over his insurance to his wife. Mrs. Porter said she would bury her brother and give us $800 out of the insurance money. Giancola and Porter quickly folded and confessed. At trial, the goal of the Giancola brothers was to make sure Porter shared whatever fate was in store. Both men took the stand, confessed their guilt, pointed a finger at Porter as the ringleader, and threw themselves on the mercy of the court. Porter's day acted alone. Defense was a miserable failure, and three guilty verdicts were returned. Appeals were quickly dismissed and the punishments were allowed to stand. The executions were placed on hold after the mother of Giancola, desperate to save her son's life, convinced the lieutenant governor, who was acting as temporary governor in the absence of his boss, that she had new evidence that would save her child. The new evidence, Porter gave Giancola a sexually transmitted disease, was not enough to tilt the scales of justice in the young man's favor. On January 27, 1938, the governor of Illinois said he could not find any justification for granting clemency to stolid Mrs. Marie Porter or to Angelo Ralph Giancola, the handsome youth she hired to kill her brother. The next day, shortly after midnight, Giancola and Porter died, one after the other, in the electric chair. From start to finish, the executions took under an hour. The two condemned prisoners, who had not seen each other since the trial, made similar statements expressing remorse for their crime and praying for God's mercy. Thank you for watching Death Row.